welcome. I am going to talk about a few things tonight, mostly homemade instruments, a few different things I've built. My name's Nathan Hubbard. I'm doing this for the live stream. You guys know who I am. And I've been doing homemade instruments since the late 90s. Actually, how I started was a friend of mine traded me an electronic pad in the 90s, which broke at some point, and I had to take it apart, and I realized it was really just a contact mic. These are a few pictures of different performances, but what we're talking about here is a contact mic, which is a piezo transducer, and it's usually attached to a jack. So I took this pad apart and I realized, oh, you can make these mics really easily by going to get Radio Shack and buying a piezo buzzer. As you see in the previous picture, here it's in the Radio Shack thing. You can crack those open, pull out the disc. For this one, I've actually soldered on the wire. You can also use the wire that comes with it that's attached. This one is broken. These things are kind of delicate, so they pretty easily break. Most of the stuff I make, I'm using a jack instead of attaching a cable to it, but that's also possible as well, depending on what you're doing. These are a couple pictures of different contact mics I made. The red mic is actually dipped in plastic, and it's waterproof, so you can put it underwater. And these are cables. Notice here, these cables are non-shielded cables, which means you hit the cable and it makes a noise, which sucks. So don't do that. Depending on what you're doing, you would either use a jack or a cable. For me, most of the stuff I make are large frames. The very first frame I built was actually this large metal grate. And I had it hanging from a stand, and I realized it's kind of quiet, but it would be cool if I could amplify it, and maybe I could use a contact mic, so I put a contact mic on the stand. It didn't work quite as well as I hoped. The vibrations going from the instrument to the cable onto the frame doesn't really work as well. This piece as well, I was using, and I realized at some point I just need to put a mic on it. You can see right here in the middle, I've attached a contact mic and the jack, so I can actually just plug a cable right into that and into an amplifier. From these larger pieces, I realized I had a bunch of smaller pieces, and I started putting together pieces like this. This is the first frame I built. You notice there's a bunch of different things. There's springs. And there's also springs right here in the middle. There's a large pipe wrap on the bottom. There's also smaller springs on the sides, hard-boiled egg slicer, several knives, canteen knives. There's also a bunch of smaller cymbals on the side. The projection's getting cut off, but there's a few metal pieces on the top. And also down here, there's several motors. Early on, I decided that amplified motors would be the coolest thing I could do, so I built this whole thing with four or five motors. This is a close-up. You can see the back. I put the contact mic right here. In the middle, these smaller springs, and then you see the thing, and we also have the power cables coming off of these motors. Frame two. I decided to make a larger one with bicycle wheels and also bass strings. See the guitar tuners up here. There's also a bunch of pieces, a tomato slicer and a few other things. This one proved even more cumbersome than the first one and was quickly scrapped and used for different pieces. I realized that hauling around two of these is just completely insane. This is a performance at Del Mar. With Head On Off, which is a dance troupe where I was using two different frames. I realized it was way too much to haul around, and after ripping up a few seats in rental cars on tour, I thought, maybe we can find some smaller ones. This is a bad example of continuing to build larger things. This is a harp frame. It's kind of hard to see, but there's actually strings. I'm using industrial wire. The problem with this one was that I used a pretty weak construction, so the entire thing started to bend. You can see here it's got all the wires, and if you notice, if you look at this side, it's already starting to bend from the pressure of the strings. This one was taken apart. My first smaller one was built from a snare drum shell. As the previous one, it's got a few cymbals. It's a pot top from a smaller pot. Has similar things like the welding rods and the springs, and some of the similar structural parts as the other thing, but designed to put on a snare drum stand and a little bit easier to carry around on tour. I also built this square one, which uses a few things and a bunch of different bowls. This piece, actually, I ended up not liking quite as much, and I scrapped quite a bit of this to put on my most recent one, which you see right here. You notice quite a few of these pieces were taken from frame two and the square frame that we just saw. You've got two soap dishes, my great-grandfather's soap dishes, a, what do you call that? Mixer, thank you, a hand crank mixer, tomato slicer, hard-boiled egg slicer, a dog flea comb, and a very large garage spring. There's also a metal plate and a small cymbal. So you get all sorts of sounds. This is a hand crank. Now, depending on how you want to play these things, the problem with the contact mic is you're literally, it's like you're hitting the face of a microphone. So I usually use chopsticks and a bow, and occasionally I'll use my fingers. You can also use so there's all these options, and of course with a bow you can get longer sounds. Depending on the pressure and what kind of bow you're using, you can get all sorts of different sounds. Odd-shaped metal is always interesting to bow. Cymbals are always interesting to bow. Take this right here. This is the side of the tomato slicer. Notice if I'm bowing this part, you can get much lower sounds. When I'm bowing the front, you can get higher pitch sounds. So there's all sorts of sounds to be used from these. When I first started making them, I put out a recording. I want to play a little bit of that, where I kind of used them as different etudes, maybe, where each piece used a different approach to the instrument. So this first one is chopsticks and a little bit of distortion. Sort of the different ways of attacks. Here's just fingers. Much softer, much more gentle. Like this, it's kind of similar to guitar where you can bend the string. The same thing where you're able to bend different parts of the instrument to make the pitches change, especially on something like this. As you're playing it, you can easily bend it to get all sorts of different vibrato and things like that. Here's a little bit with the bow, and I think a little bit of delay. This one goes back the chopsticks, but has a little bit of motor on it. Actually, let me move it ahead a little bit. Actually the motor and a boat cymbal. You're getting these multiple sounds with a little bit of harmonizer as well. As I mentioned, these are all kind of demos. What I ended up doing was, when I first built these, you know, I was doing a lot of recording with them, trying to figure out what they sounded like, what they were best used for. I ended up cutting up a lot of these pieces and turning it into a recording. That piece actually, I really liked what happened, so I ended up doing a second take later on with different recording gear and used it for a CD I put out. Sorry, my levels are all over the place. This is the only document I have of me playing both the frame one and frame two. Notice with a contact mic there's sort of a slightly nasal thing happening where you have to be careful with the EQing, and definitely sort of a frequency range where there's a lack of lows and lack of highs. You're hearing a lot of lows and highs because I'm using certain effects, and of course when you get to something like this you realize you can plug it in. You realize, oh, I can plug in all these guitar effects and things like that. before we start talking about effects, I do want to point out that this version of Frame 1 is probably, I think, the most recent, and you notice it's changed quite a bit. I took out all the motors and added more pipe wrap and more springs down below. And I also added this large mixer right here. It's kind of hard to see in the picture. So I continue to sort of modify these things, change things out as I find more interesting pieces, and just depending on what I'm using them for. So the contact mic, not only with the frame, here you can see the frame in the background, but I was also using contact mics on cymbals and drums, and of course running them through effects. Early on, I didn't have much money, so I was borrowing effects from guitar players. And I'm sure every person that uses effects realize they start with the cheesiest effects possible. Here I have a phase shifter and it's a delay, and I believe that's another phaser. So I have some pretty terrible effects, and actually quite a few recordings that I'm going to play. I have one recording that's so bad I had to bring it just because it's the overuse of delay is kind of insane. So this is actually the first performance that I ever used frame one on. Luckily, as time wore on, I got a little bit better about using effects. This is a few years after this. I still am using a little bit of delay, sans amp for using some slightly overdrive effects, and a compressor. As time wore on, I sort of delved deeper into this, trying to figure out what worked and what didn't work for me. A lot of the modulation effects I found not very exciting with contact mics. Looking for sounds that weren't just overdrive, although I was definitely using overdrive. This is a picture on tour in Seattle, the square frame, sort of extended drum kit. Notice on the effects loop I have a compressor, pitch shifter, a delay, overdrive, and a tremolo pedal, and a harmonizer pedal. So I'm trying to jump into some of these effects that maybe push these sounds a little bit more. If I could play, this is a live recording from Oregon. Sorry, let me say, since I played a terrible version, let me play a good version of something I actually enjoy the effects on. Obviously, when you get into this, you're building something, you find it exciting, and you start playing with it, and after a while, you have to start questioning, okay, why am I using this? What sound? Why am I being drawn to these sounds, or what am I using them for? So for me, it's always been an extension of acoustic sounds. Clearly, with drums, you can get quite low in frequency range. You've got concert bass drums, large tam-tams, things like that. As a working drummer, as a touring drummer, it's pretty hard to drag around a lot of that stuff. You see here, my largest drum is an 18-inch drum. I do have a tam-tam and some larger cymbals. But for me, the electronics is a way to go lower than that, go higher than that, and also have more sustain than some of these instruments. So we just listen to something where I'm using a little bit of pitch shifting. to get some frequency range that's not really possible unless you get up into triangles and things like that. One of the other effects I seem to defer to a lot is the tremolo, which when used, I found that using it kind of defers back to some of the drumistic kind of tendencies of playing a lot, where I can mess with different tempo issues and things like that. Frequency range. You've got that sort of high jingly from the chains on the snare drum. You've got this kind of insistent sound from the frame and the tremolo. Occasionally little bits of lower frequencies coming from the bass drum. You've got this whole kind of interesting frequency range. So that's what I'm going for. This is probably the most recent setup, or the current setup. Compression, overdrive, a little bit of delay, distortion, tremolo, a little bit of a chaos pad using to affect things, and I'll talk about that a little bit, and then starting to get into circuit bend instruments. There have been a little bit of use of me using contact mics on the kit, but before I get to that, one of the things I realized when I got into effects is you can plug the effects into themselves and create, we're talking about sustain and creating things that go on and on. You can create feedback loops from these things. So this is a couple different things that I've used. You start to realize that certain pedals work better just by plugging them into each other. Phasers, certain tremolo pedals don't work quite as well feeding back onto themselves. So you can use different things. What I've found is using a no-input setup of mostly distortion and overdrive pedals, and then sending that signal out to a secondary chain. Let me play. This is a no-input piece. Thank you.
One of the things I love about no input is that coming from a drummer standpoint, you're always thinking about forward motion and things like that. Playing laptop, playing samples, we'll talk about field recordings a little bit later. A lot of that, it's you have to slow yourself down. You have to move very slow. And I love that too, but sometimes you want to move fast. You want to, lots of rates of change and thing. And no input's real easy to get things like that happening. That was just no input. Let me play you a piece with no input sort of interfacing with metal percussion. But that's actually that earlier grade I showed you, one of the earlier pieces. I think this is the only recording I have of this. So the no input became like another instrument in this rig. You've got these amplified things, you've got the contact mics, you have these effects, and then the effects working on themselves. Another common effect that a lot of people use is a looping device or different things like this. I've tried different aspects of this over the years. You saw earlier pictures, there was a sampler. I've been doing some real-time sampling. Honestly, the real-time sampling's never worked for me. The one thing that I have found interesting is using an older tape delay, like an Echoplex. They have a feature called Sound on Sound, and the Echoplex is literally a tape delay. It's got a reel-to-reel, and it's taking the signal and using the reel to delay the signal. You can do a Sound on Sound as well, where it's recording onto the tape and it keeps overdubbing on top of each other. It's about a 3-minute tape. So it's not like a loop where you can actually play boom, boom, gather, and it lines up. You're basically just adding sounds. So there's all sorts of possibilities of sort of layering things in, and clearly it's analog, so the farther it gets along, things get a little bit creaky and things like this. One of the first pieces I did with this is, what? No, not that. Here we go. So this piece, I actually used this snare drum, which is filled with wooden beads, and contact mic'd it, and put a few different contact mics on different drums, set this up. I've told this story a few times, it's kind of funny, where I would play for a little bit. Hi, come on in. So I literally set this up, let it play into the Echoplex. I would play for a couple minutes, and I literally just got up and went and got some water. Let it record, let it loop up on itself, and then I'd play it back, come back and play some more. and I had a recording going the whole time. I have an hour-long version of this piece. It really gets interesting about 20 minutes. I don't know how I would do this live, but it was interesting to record this way where I would literally go do something, come back, play a little bit. Let me play you a little bit of that. largest, that sound is literally this snare drum. I would literally just stir these sounds, give it a little bit of space. That's why you're hearing all these things. And then this sound comes in again. So you're getting all these pretty dense sounds with these kind of high frequency stuff happening. After this record, there was a woman who was hanging out at the mastering studio, and she referred to this track as Breathing Gravel, which I always thought was hilarious. One other thing about contact mics is not only is this picking up the vibrations of this, if you put this instrument on the ground, like you've seen all these pictures, these frames are sitting on the ground, it's picking up the frequency. If you stomp your foot, it's going to pick up that vibration as well. If you're on a stage that maybe is hollow or has a little bit of sound transference, you're going to pick that up as well. It's really easy to let things feed back. Sometimes that can be really annoying, and then sometimes you can just sort of flow with it. I played on a few different stages where I sort of couldn't control things and everything became this big wall of sound because everything I was playing on the acoustic instruments was being transferred from the stage up into the instrument and through the contact mic. This recording is a solo with an orchestra backing, but I thought it was interesting that as it happened, the recording, the floor we were using actually transferred a lot of the sound and started feeding back into the amplifier. Shifter. So, starting pretty simply, homemade instruments, contact mics, running them through effects, using different ways of using the effects. Obviously, you're putting this stuff into a computer because you're recording this. The next step is maybe not totally obviously, but fairly obviously, that you start using the computer to process these things. My playlist is out of order, but I'm... A couple of things that I've done and this will come up even more later on, is that I was using compression and expansion. So, for example, I take an audio file that was 2 minutes long and scoot it down to 30 seconds. This piece is actually a bunch of recordings I set up in front of a piano, put a brick on the piano, a pedal, so the strings are resonating, put contact mics on the piano and played the drums so the vibrations were hitting the strings and the contact mics were picking up the piano. Then I took that audio and smushed it down so it was way faster. So you hear things that are extremely fast, but it's actually because the audio has been squished. This kind of stuff is not possible live. Often what I end up doing is using recordings of this in a live situation where I'll bring in some of these recordings. You notice here, acoustic, this is actually the release for my first CD, Born on Tuesday. And you notice I have both frames. I think this is the only performance where I actually used both frames and put contact mics on every drum. It took me like 3 hours to set up. This is the point where I realize this is not feasible and I need to stop doing this because it's not worth it. It works for certain people. Chris Cutler does this amazingly. But for me, it was way too much work and I was spending too much time setting up and not being able to worry about the music. So I moved on. In fact, the larger frames, you guys just came in. Let me show you some larger frames real quick. Let's go back. Here's some of the larger frames. These are large metal instruments that I built. They all use these contact mics that we've been talking about. The problem with these larger frames is every single time you use one of these frames on a performance, everybody wants to talk about the instrument. Nobody cares about the music. I could have not played at all and people would have been like, dude, that thing is awesome. And understandably, they're kind of cool looking, but at some point I was hoping people would want to talk about the structure or the sound or these different things that are happening. It never happened. It became an albatross, and I realized that I needed to get away from it and maybe only use it very sporadically or use it for very specific situations. I continue to build things using different parts of this, sort of pushing the contact mic idea. This is a string board. It's a 2x4. And it uses two broken strings. These strings were actually from a piano that Mo Staino destroyed with an axe in a performance in San Francisco. Nick knows what I'm talking about. And I have a pickup on the side. The problem with using a wooden frame instead of a metal frame is that the sound isn't transferred quite as well, so you're not getting as well a good of a sound. The string idea, of course, immediately made me start thinking about wind harps. Now, a wind harp is an interesting, you actually don't touch the strings. The strings play themselves. The wind blows across them and allows the strings to vibrate. This piece, the top is cut off, but it's actually about 5-6 feet tall, and it's got this pickup. This is actually on a roof. I had it up on a roof and ran a cable down and recorded several hours of it. I've got some recording of this. Let's listen to this. Sorry. if you listen in depth, hi, come on in. If you listen very in depth, you're hearing a lot of wind noise and you're hearing a lot of interference. This is where I realized that the contact mic was maybe not the best spot for an instrument like this, where I could be using maybe a magnetic pickup or different things like that. There are some pretty decent sounds coming out, actually. This in the file of still being worked on. I want to build a larger wind harp with more strings, a little bit bigger with a metal frame, and some sort of different pickup. I don't think the contact mic idea works for this. Some other ideas that I've been dealing with are, I forgot to say, I did have an entire project built around this wind harp called the Lost Balloon Society, which you can't see, it's off, right up top, cut off. And I did a couple performances where I took the audio that I recorded and did live sort of ambient improvisations with this. One other thing that I've been doing recently is building sort of industrial imbiras. Imbira is a thumb piano. There's a couple different names, imbira, kalimba. So these use larger pieces of metal. This one's the biggest one I've made, and it uses aluminum strips. And uses a contact mic as well. There's also a smaller one, this one right here, which I actually brought with me. And this uses pipe wrap. As you can hear, it's very quiet. But with an amplifier, you can, with a pickup, it becomes a much more interesting instrument. And actually, you can see here, I'm running it through an effects. I have, let me play a little bit of a little Endura. This is, it's hard to tell, this is sort of in the background, but you're hearing. Do that very rhythmic thing in the middle is this larger era. To be honest, this is sort of in the works as well. I feel like the contact mic doesn't really work as well. There's a sort of a new technology right now called a piezo wire. This is a piezo transducer, a piezo wire that a lot of people are using. The Array Ambira people are using that. So my plan right now is to disassemble these and use some piezo wire. One last thing with the, I apologize about this. My wife told me I had to include this picture. Contact mics are great for underwater recording. So here's me in my grandmother's pool recording gongs, and here's a little bit of that recording. This is actually not a gong, it's a triangle. You notice the contact mic, like I mentioned before, sort of squashes the frequency range, but you get some interesting resonance. The water allows sound to transfer a little bit differently than you would hear in air. Thank you. skim through this and play a little bit of some different parts of it. So the water recording is kind of interesting, a good use of the contact mics. Actually, I realize this picture is perfect as a segue because I wanted to talk about people often see these things and say, oh, how did you come up with this? And there's actually a pretty good history of different people doing these things. Now check out this segue. Everybody ready? Another guy with his shirt off. This is Max Neuhaus. He's a famous percussionist. He's also sort of the person that started and defined the idea of installation art. He has one of the longest standing pieces in Times Square, which most people think is just some weird sound coming out of a subway grate. It's actually been there since the 70s. American percussionist that debuted a lot of sort of high modernist, new complexity pieces, and sort of shifted his perception of what music is in the 70s, started actually releasing music that was just circuits. Literally, instead of buying a record or a cassette or something, you would buy this circuit, which created sound. This recording is actually a solo recording on Columbia Records, I believe it's 65, it might be 67. The first time I heard somebody using feedback, somebody using extended percussion, somebody using electronics. So this was a major influence for me. Another influence was this guy, Tony Oxley, a British drummer, originally what you'd call a jazz drummer, but quickly moving into the free improvisation realm. You notice a lot of homemade instruments. He has a very large cowbell, a lot of homemade stands, and then also a frame back here with a tomato slicer and a knife and a few other things as well. As well as Tony, this man, Paul Litton, who's a contemporary of Tony, and sort of building his own instruments about the same time, was a major influence. You notice in the earlier picture of frame one, there was this weird mixer that I bolted onto it. That was actually a complete ripoff when I saw this picture with him using that. I thought, oh, I gotta try this. Paul's instruments are interesting because he's mostly using guitar strings and guitar pickups. He went through a couple different phases where he was using military microphones, and now he's using guitar pickups. So his instruments often sound like an extended electric guitar. You notice he's got some smaller percussion instruments over here and a small synthesizer back here to amplify these instruments. Another major influence is in the picture of him. It's a picture of his setup, is Chris Cutler, who's well known for his work with Henry Cow and the Art Bears. This is somebody, the first person I saw contact mic. Actually, he doesn't use contact mics, he uses lapel mics. A bunch of different drums and runs them through different effects. You can see he's got a bunch of different effects chains here and smaller drums. So there's a lot of people out there doing really interesting work with electronics and different things like that. Before all of these people, major influence is this guy, David Tudor, who started out as a pianist working with the composer John Cage. And he quickly became interested in electronics, building his own circuits and different things like that. He has a piece called Rainforest, which is basically a bunch of amplified metal instruments that is sort of an installation. So those are some older influences. Some more recent influences, I'm going to start talking about different recordings and things. This is a recording of...
Sorry.
You guys leaving? No, don't leave.
They're being a little too chatty. It's chatty right. Pathies, but thank you.
Thank you for coming. This is Kevin Keyes. He's a drummer in an industrial band called Skinny Puppy. If you look, it sort of looks like a normal 1980s rock drum kit. You've got your normal drums and some electronic pads. These pads up here are actually triggering radios. We're going to talk about this in a second, where you can trigger radios and different things from pads. And I would be hard to say this man wasn't influenced. Bill Bruford, this is his 1980s setup with King Crimson. Notice his Simmons electronic pads. Sort of one of the first person to deal with different triggers. Also some excellent sunglasses in this picture, you have to say. Okay, moving on. We've been talking about contact mics, instruments. You notice in most of these pictures you're seeing a sampler or a Discman or something where I'm playing different audio. I do a lot of field recordings, and of course I record a lot of audio and use them in performances. So I wanted to talk about different playback devices and then also about different recordings. Let's start with playback devices and recordings. One of the in the 90s, this piece of equipment came out, the mini disc, which was totally out of my price range at that point, but I bought one anyways. And you have these discs you see over here. This is actually a large tub I have of mini discs of different performances and recordings. When I bought this, it seemed pretty natural for me to immediately just start recording not only gigs, but sounds. I was living in Encinitas, and there were some trees behind my bedroom, and the birds would, about 4 in the morning, would start singing. And I have a bunch of recordings where I would wake up and set my alarm, set this thing up at 3 o'clock, and just go back to bed. And I have these recordings of the sun coming up and these birds singing. So there was always these thoughts of using these recordings and recording these sounds and maybe using them in performances as well. The mini disc was the main thing. I also use a lot of cassettes. This actually came up. I know it's very popular now to have a 4-track and use that as in a performance. I never did that. My friend Curtis Glatter was deep into cassettes and was always giving me cassettes. So I've been using cassettes a little bit more in maybe the last 15 years than I have. Notice these are a bunch of different performances, 4-track dubs, and these are actually Smithsonian tapes that you can get on cassette that I've used. One of my favorite things is I have a Walkman that has a variable speed on it, so I can play different cassettes at different speeds. Also, I found these in a dumpster, and it was kind of a life-changing moment. These are all recordings from the Tucson Tabernacle, Brother Perry Green, all of his sermons. I don't know why anybody would throw these away, because these are amazing. I've actually used different samples from this throughout different things. I have a whole record that uses some of these. Let me play you a couple. What do I got here? Okay, this is a recording that I did where I decided all of the samples that we were going to use are going to come from cassettes. Let me skip ahead a little bit. This is where we're coming from. It kind of drops into this. Music, you hear certain recordings come up over the years. One of them is my grandfather was a fervent Reagan supporter, and through that, Reagan actually sent him, or Reagan's, I assume he has some sort of foundation or something, sent him cassette recordings of his speeches, which I somehow ended up with. So there's little bits of Reagan and a little bit of all of my music. That history is a rhythm, here is Reagan. This is kind of as far as I've gone in terms of density, using multiple different samples, a lot of things happening pretty quickly, things moving. I've also used cassettes. I have a piece that I want to play that uses cassette recordings culled from when I was in high school, I went to San Diego High School in Encinitas, and somehow I ended up with all the judging tapes from the marching band. I was a marching band geek. My band director was fired. I don't even want to go into all this. Anyways, I ended up making a piece about this using samples from these tapes. This actually uses, kind of like the last piece, some live band, and this is sort of a combination of judging tapes from field record from field tournaments and live band. But there's a little bit of use of radio samples here as well. Is kind of interesting. I'm still sort of using them in different regards. Another option that I like to use is the turntable. Of course, when you talk about the turntable, you can't help talk about hip-hop and using samples from that. I like to reference a couple different things. I was a big fan of Christian Marclay, who's a turntable artist, but also modifies turntables. It's kind of hard to see, but if you look at this record right here, I've actually drilled a separate borehole, so the whole record goes out of sync with itself as it's playing, creating some different sounds. These modifications are cool as well. Vinyl for me is, I guess all of these things for me are about choices and picking specific things. I have a huge collection of flexi discs. Everybody know what a flexi disc is? Flexi discs are like things that you would get in a magazine. It's literally like a very thin plastic sheet, and it would have, for example, this one's from Modern Drummer. It's Simon Phillips. And that is, actually all three of these are from Modern Drummer. That's a Yamaha demoing some new drum set they have, and that's a Paiste thing with people playing their instruments. That's a DJ Tension self-cut lathe flexi disc. So I like to use these as well. As you see in this picture right here, this turntable goes down to 16 RPM, normal RPM 33, 45. Pulling it down to 16 RPM, you get much slower things and you can affect that. Notice also I'm using this chaos pad to affect the sound. So for me, it's often about choices and what I'm doing. I have a pretty large collection of vinyl. You notice here, these are all local concert and marching bands. We have a Civic Youth Orchestra from 1964. The Grossmont High School Blue and Gold from 66, and Sounds of the Hemet High School Instrumental Music Department. I use all of these for samples and different things like that. So next, oh yes, and of course I am a huge fan of the 60s self-help recordings, including How Your Mind Can Help Keep You Well. So I use all these. Like I mentioned, it's kind of hard not to talk about hip-hop, and I do use samples like this in creating hip-hop tracks. I've been playing with an MC named Parker Edison. I want to play a little bit of a track I've been working on. This one was kind of funny because it's entirely culled from a Rick James album. Except for the guy muttering about his mind.
Mm-hmm.
anyways, you get the idea. There's plenty of options with that. I would like to talk about CDs. I don't have a picture. Clearly, in the 90s, there was a lot of people using CDs, Kid 606, Oval, different people like that, who were sort of pouring glue on CDs and modifying them. Kid 606 is infamous for sticking a screwdriver into a CD player while some NWA CD played and messing with it. I actually had a pretty life-changing moment. My wife, back when we were dating, she used to drive around. She was a huge fan of Tori Amos. She had these Tori Amos CDs. She also liked soda a lot, and the middle compartment of her car had different sodas, and the cups would sort of disintegrate, and you'd have soda gunk and these Tori Amos CDs. We were driving around once, and I put this Tori Amos CD in. I didn't look, but it was covered in the back with dried soda gunk, and it got to a certain point where just like a skipping CD, skipping record, it actually skipped on the CD. It was kind of this amazing moment. It was, you know, Tori Amos was hitting this high note, and it was this perfect loop. I literally spent months trying to recreate that. I had different CDs, Q-tips, different kinds of soda. I would try all these different things. I tried to scratch them, CDRs, glue, different. None of it worked. I got completely fed up. There's a little bit of skipping CD on one of my solo records, but I completely gave up on the CD thing. Radio, however, I use quite a bit. You can see this radio right here is actually the same one in this picture. This is live in Ensenada. So I've used radio for a bunch of different things. This first piece I want to play was a commission from a dancer in New York, and it was used on a dance piece. A lot of the effects I use on the frame, tremolo, pitch shifting, things like that. Oh my god, that was a quick switch. I played you these pieces where I'm using samples from the radio. I love sort of talk, I don't listen to talk radio, but I love sampling these things. Here's a little bit from that same session as a marching band thing where we use some different things.
We only have a few more days to stop this little menace, but it depends on you taking action. Go to freedomworksforus.com right now for free access to your congressman's phone number. Call them immediately until they pledge to fund Obamacare. There's not a moment to lose.
There's not a moment to lose. You get the idea. One thing that I've found really interesting lately, sort of a ripoff from the picture of Kevin Keyes' setup, I've been using radio triggered by pads. What I'm using here is a setup where I'm using a gate. A gate is actually a technology where it holds the sound in. If you push enough sound through it, the gate opens and it closes again. So literally, this radio is playing. The gate is holding it closed. When I hit this pad, it's actually opening the trigger. Right? Kind of makes some interesting things. You can imagine using several gates and several different pads, using different radios tuned to different stations. You can actually control how much of the pad plays, too. That's as short as it goes for this one. I have another module that'll get even shorter. Thank you. So lots of options there. I've been using this in a couple different settings, mostly live settings. It's been kind of an interesting learning situation to figure out how to tune in different radios, especially if you're driving around, you play LA, you play Bakersfield, Tijuana, Ensenada. This is sort of my usual tour performing area. There's all sorts of different options of what you're going to hear, things you can tune into. Okay, we've talked about different playback options. One of the main things that I do and I've been doing since the 90s is field recordings. Clearly people have been doing this since the recording devices began. You have Harry Smith and people like that who are out recording peyote rituals and things like that. For me, I showed you the mini disc. That's been one of my main things that I use for years. Recently, my mini disc doesn't work as well, so I haven't been using it. The two things that I do use are a phone, and I have a couple different recording devices on that where I control gain input. Anybody that has an iPhone, of course, has the voice memo. That's really easy, but it's really easy if it's in a loud situation for that audio to clip and distort. There's a couple different options of apps you can use that can control that input. The internal microphone's not that great, but if you're walking around, you know, you guys step out of here and something cool happens down there, you want to record it, you got your phone. Another thing I've been using is this Zoom. I have it actually right here. We're recording the lecture. So, the really interesting thing is the what, right? What do you record? Obviously, the easiest things to record are sort of atmospheric things. You're in the country and you record some crickets. I got some crickets. I'll play some crickets. It's in Massachusetts. Recording nature sounds is great. It's actually completely impossible because we live in such an industrial world to actually get away from cars passing. I can't tell you how long I spent on just this recording. Every time a car passed, I cut it out, put the audio back together, crossfade it to make it sound natural, all these different things. It's true of pretty much any recording you do. How do you get those sounds? The really tricky thing is trying to figure out interesting things, sporting events, walking around, cityscapes, all sorts of different things. Depending on the situation, I will use original source material, or what I've been doing a lot, as I mentioned before, is using a computer to process some of this stuff. I've been doing some extreme expanding. Let me play you. This is the bells at the Mission, San Diego de Alcala in Mission Valley. First time I think they've been rang in 30 or some years. So we went down and I took this Zoom and stood behind the building and recorded it from about 20 feet. Turned out really nice. It's about 4 minutes long. I found that when I stretched it out, it got really interesting. Let me play a few different ones. Here's the first stretch. Right, you're hearing those same attacks with the waves stretched out. I think I have an even more messed up one. Let's see. Oh yeah, this one adds a little bit of noise to the equation. As a composer, I love listening to these things, but of course, as a composer, you immediately say, oh no, my Facebook feed's ruined. Terrible. Oh no, we're back. Okay, thank you. Bye. Okay. You immediately start to wonder, okay, what do I do with this? I have to do something. Usually that leads to trouble. Of course, the obvious thing is to take this and write, you know, some melodic material over it. Let me play one of those. This is some serious process and re-EQ'd low rumble sounds from contact mics on a structure, and then also some rain recordings and a few other things. Notice some of the recordings, sorry, I'm trying not to stop this, but some of the pitch material that comes out of the field recording I've taken and used and harmonized for some of the melodic material. So you hear that? Specific field recordings and building a piece around them. I also have literally this phone doesn't even work except for to play audio files. I have a large collection of field recordings and I use them in different performances, sometimes on the fly, sometimes worked out. This recording is from underneath, everybody knows Spreckles right there, yeah? So this is in the basement underneath the stage and it's a bunch of people practicing the ballet for West Side Story. You also hear a very loud buzzing, which is one of the electrical works in the building. Intro to a piece. from a performance in LA that was actually improvised, where I just used that as the opening to a piece. Seemed to work pretty well for that. For those of you that were here a little bit before we started, I played this piece, which is a sort of long-form drone piece I wrote. And let me play you a little bit where I... it takes a while to get going, but you're hearing... No! Sorry, I'm screwing up. There we go. Drone is actually a couple different things. It's a recording of people working on the freeway in the middle of the night. My wife was pregnant and she had kicked me out of my bed and onto the couch, where I was forced to listen to this stuff from the freeway, and I ended up getting up in the middle of the night and going down and recording it. And then overdubbed. Let me scrub it back a little bit. A lot of wife stories tonight. I don't know what's going on. You can hear that. Those are actually Keat tea kettles that I just put on the stove and recorded them, the whistle. So this piece was all about using field recordings and overdubbing stuff into them. There is actually a piece I'm going to get to. No, I went too far. Here we go. Synthesizer is actually several vases with microphones put in them, put an amplifier right next to it to feedback. And controlling where your hand is over the vase and where the microphone is, you can change the pitch of that. So you're hearing all these different pitch material, but it's actually just feedback. So a few different ideas about how to use field recordings. I've finally gotten to the point where I don't want to overdub pitch material. I don't want to overdub anything. I have been working on a bunch of different pieces recently using just the field recordings, sometimes two or three field recordings overdubbed, but just dealing with that and letting them play out. I want to play one of them, and I'm going to get up and get another beer. It's a dryer, but yes, a it's actually stretched out strings, people warming up before a show. But what I love about this is there's so many things to listen to. You can just focus on the sort of rhythmic digga digga digga, or you can focus on how these different things interact. You can focus on all these different things. The sound is so thick and interesting, and it's not completely static. Even if it was static, I think it'd be interesting. this could be the point where we end. Is anybody getting bored? Should we keep going? Talk a little more? Anybody have questions?
I have questions.
Yes.
How did you get access to Bill under Spreckles while they were practicing?
I was doing West Side Story, and the bathroom is in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
So you, I'm serious. You go down there to use the bathroom.
What do you mean you were
doing
it? Like,
what's that?
What do you mean you were, how are you?
I was playing the show. I was the percussionist. I was playing the mallet book, which was vibraphone, xylophone, two bongos, two timbales, three timpani, chimes, concert bass drum, whatever else. What's that?
No partridge in a pear tree.
And a part, yeah, exactly. Yeah, I was there doing a performance, and you go down there. There's actually, they do use the basement sometimes for the orchestra. For that show, we were actually behind the stage. But yeah, people go down there to dress, and I was there early to tune the timpani, and I went down there, and I was like, wow, this is amazing, and I literally pulled out my phone and went and stood there for 5 minutes recording it. Yeah. Some of these things just happen, like I was saying about the finding those cassettes, you know, you just happen to be in these situations, and hopefully I try and travel around with that thing in my bag at all times. It doesn't always work, and I have this phone if not. But there's always something interesting. You know, I was at the fair, and we went down this weird tunnel where all these kids were kind of yelling, and the echo was really weird, and I pulled out my phone and recorded that really quick. So there's always these sounds. It's just kind of finding those situations and figuring out where they are and how you get them. Anything else? Yes, Jerome.
I saw you, so you've done the whole water recording bonds.
Yes.
Have you ever, kind of like with the snare drum and the wooden beads, have you ever filled some kind of container with a liquid versus beads or metal or air? Or oil or something?
Yeah, water's an interesting thing. Clearly, there's a lot of use of what they call a water gong, which is basically a tub of water and you dip a gong in it. You dip anything, especially a metal instrument, into it, it changes the pitch. You heard that in the recording. I was playing that triangle and I was dipping it in the water. So I've done a lot of that. Is it the first construction? John Cage's first construction uses a water gong. So there's a lot of that. When I was a kid, I bought this book called A Planet Drum by Mickey Hart from the Grateful Dead, and there's a bunch of pictures of water drums, which are actually big calabashes or gourds, and they split them in half and they put them with water, and they take a smaller gourd, split it in half, and put it upside down in the water, and you hit it. Water is a pretty amazing instrument. There's a long tradition of Native Americans using water drums, which is literally a skin drum with water in it, and the water allows the resonance to go. So I have all these different things. I don't think I've ever built a drum that just had water in it. I have used the water drums quite a bit, the calabashes. I have to admit, I don't think I've taken it quite as far. Just hauling the water drums around is enough of a pain in the butt, because you get to a performance space and you're like, great, is there a hose around here? You know, you're like, and then you get done and you're like, great, where do I dump this water? And you have to like dry the gourds out, make sure they're all cool. And yeah, so it's a little bit of a pain in the butt. That recording was enough to show me that, like, okay, I could do this farther, but maybe there's enough. See, James. Anybody else? Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about the technical process of recording underwater with a contact mic?
Yes. You take the contact mic. For me, I waterproof them by using Dip It, which is a liquid plastic. People use it to put on the handles of like tools. And you can buy it in a hardware store or at a sporting goods store. And it's literally just a tube of plastic. You can put your finger in it and waterproof your finger. So I dip the contact mic in. Let's go back to that picture. And then let it dry. My goal was to use a DAT recorder, which is a recorder that you have to plug into the wall. And my wife told me I was going to electrocute myself and that I couldn't do that. So what I ended up doing, you see right here, see how they're all red?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the waterproof part. This is just a cable. It's not a shielded cable. If you listen to that recording, you hear a little bit where the water starts to splash and the cable goes across the concrete a little bit. And that cable will make sound because it's not shielded. So I literally just plugged that into a mini disc recorder, jumped in, played gong for a while, played triangle. I had some different metal instruments I was interested in, and that was about it. Set the level and went. There's you can go way farther with this. People build hydrophones and different things like that. Alan Jones was here, right? Did he talk about that? He's a sonar technician, and actually he has a bunch of really interesting recordings because he spends all his time on a submarine listening to audio, listening to sonar, and every submarine is set up with these different microphones so they can track what's going on around them. Sound actually travels faster through water than it does through air, so it's really interesting when you get into that. There's all sorts of strange things that happen. And there's plenty of people. I mentioned Tony Oxley earlier. He's done some pieces where he had different performers in a pool. There's been plenty of stuff over the years where people have used pools as a performance space, and doing live performances in schools can have the water changes the sound. Anybody else? Anybody want to touch the springs? Well, if everybody's not bored, let's talk about cymbals for a second. Oh yeah, hey, don't forget, a week from Saturday, Lou Damien's putting out his first record. This has never happened. Jerome's on that record, I'm on the record. And then my friend Curtis is coming out from Detroit, and we're gonna play too. We have a record coming out. It's the Athenaeum Art Space at Bread and Salt. 7 o'clock, $10 donation, you'll love it. Let's talk about cymbals. Okay, so I'm a drummer, so I've spent my whole life dealing with cymbals. Cymbals break really easily. And I've been dealing with broken cymbals and what to do with them for a while. In high school, we had a broken ride cymbal that I took, and I had seen a performance of the Ripping Tins, which was a smooth jazz band from the 80s. And Steve Reed, the percussionist, had a cymbal like this, what I call ribbon cymbals. These are actually kind of popular nowadays. Different cymbal companies are making them. At that point, they were not. And so I took this cymbal, this is actually the cymbal from my high school, and I cut it into a ribbon cymbal. It sort of creates this flanger approach. These are two broken cymbals that Marcos Fernandez gave to me, and I cut into ribbons as well. And so this was my first modification. From there, I sort of tried some different ideas. You're always running into what happens when cymbals break. Everybody breaks cymbals. It's kind of like guitar strings. You know they're going to break at some point. This is Ross Afar's ride cymbal he gave to me. He had a giant crack in it, and I actually cut the crack out. That's one way to deal with it. Not the best. Well, it depends on the cymbal. It depends on the break. It depends on a lot of things. For this cymbal, that was the best thing to do. You can cut the crack out. It totally affects the sound. It's not going to have the same sound. It's going to be a little bit more trashy. Depending on the cymbal, you can cut the entire outside ring out. I use a lathe, notice here. These things are super dangerous. And I end up popping about half the cymbals I put on this thing. So I haven't been using this lathe quite as much. But when you do lay them down, you can get this nice sound. This is actually a crash cymbal that had a crack on the edge, and I lathe the outer ring out. And then I actually laid, you can see it's kind of shiny and stuff because I actually took some of the mass off. The problem with larger cymbals is when you cut them down, they're often too thick to use for anything. So I took some of the mass off this cymbal and turned it into what would be like a hi-hat. This is another hi-hat. These are, both of these cymbals were cracked. They were given to me by Sal from Secret Fun Club. And I cut them both down, and you can see I did a little bit of lathing on this one as well. This cymbal had this huge crack in it, and I decided to cut it a little bit weird so it's elongated. And then I took it and turned it over and did some lathing on the back. There's some machine lathing right here on the inside, and then some hand lathing right here on the bottom and in the bell to bring down the mass a little bit. By taking mass off the cymbal, you lower the pitch, and you're changing the sound a little. This is a ride cymbal that had a crack in it that I cut down. I've actually been using the lathe less, and I've been using I've been cutting them down with a die cutter by hand and then cleaning them off. It doesn't get quite as clean of a cut, but I don't break as many cymbals, so that's better for me. This cymbal was really interesting because I did this to it, where I cut this into segments. Now what this makes is each of these different segments creates a different pitch and you can create sounds, especially with this cymbal because it was so thick. When you're cutting down these rides, you cut them into a smaller cymbal, you have a very, very thick cymbal. This one worked really well by cutting into segments and creating these different sounds. This cymbal I'm still messing with, as you can see. It had a large crack in it. I cut it out and I tried to make it uniform. It's not really doing too much for me. My plan right now is to cut out these bigger sections and use them as plates and then cut the smaller part into a bell. Often that's what happens when you get cracks that are so far along, you get these smaller bell cymbals. The cracked portion of the cymbals I usually end up cutting into small chunks. Originally, depending on the period, for a while I was actually riveting them to other cymbals. Lately I've been cutting them into chunks and attaching them to chains to create sort of a wind chime effect. So there's a couple different options. Some other modifications that I've been doing to cymbals, this hi-hat cymbal over here you notice has four tambourine jingles. I've been doing that a lot to different cymbals, adds a ringing sound to it and deadens it a little bit because those pieces stay on it. This ride cymbal I put, I believe there's 24, something like that. I put a bunch of them, and instead of putting them close to the bell, I put them right at the edge so it completely deadens the sound. You play it, and the tambourine jingle shut the sound off. So this creates an interesting sound. This one, actually, I feel like I put too many jingles on where it's a little bit dead. I have another one that I don't have quite as many. And of course, when you start doing this, you start to realize, well, why don't I make my own cymbals? So this is a piece of aluminum that I put on a lathe and lathed out, and I did a little bit of hammering to make a bell. And this is the top from a pressure cooker, I believe. I did a fair amount of lathing and quite a bit of hammering for the bell. This showed me that I have no business making cymbals because they're freaking really hard to make. So I'm going to stick to modifications, but this was really interesting to figure out these different sounds and how they make those things. I think that's the end of my thing. Does anybody have any questions? Anyone want to try this thing? Or I also have this magic embora. I should probably put finish on this. Questions? Thoughts?
Do you have any cymbal recordings?
I don't have any cymbal recordings. I need to do some audio of some of these.
Yeah.
I need to sit down and do all of these. Most of them I've been using as a way to, I've just been modifying. Some of them I actually use for performances, but most of them I've been selling. So this has been sort of an interesting thing to take these cymbals and repurpose them. Because most of the time people just take them and throw them away. Most of the people that contact me said, well, I got all these cymbals, I was going to throw them away. Do you want them? Sure. So then I try and fix them and do something like that.
Can you recreate modified cymbal sounds? You know, if you already sold one, somebody's like, oh, I wanted that one. Would that be impossible?
Not totally impossible, but each one's kind of unique. I mean, most of them that I cut down, you have to say drummers are not the most adventurous bunch. So most of the time you're dealing with people that, except for Nick and a few other people I know. but most of the time people want like a good usable hi-hat or a good ride or a crash. You're never going to get a crash out of cutting down one of these cymbals, right? What you are going to get is a smaller cymbal. You cut down a ride or a crash, you might get it down to the weight of a hi-hat. And that's what I've been doing with these, especially this. This was a crash. The bottom, I believe, was a crash as well. And I cut them both down to the and laid them down a bit so they're a hi-hat weight. The weird, odd-shaped things, I've sold a few of those. Matt Smith bought one of my segmented cymbals. The cymbal chains, I've sold quite a few of those to different percussionists and people. But most of the time, people want something that functions as a normal cymbal that they're used to. So that's mostly what I've been going for.
Is music your main job?
Parenting is my main job, but yes, music is mostly what I do. Thanks for coming. We're gonna finish up, okay? Bye. music's kind of ridiculous where you never make quite enough money. I do quite a bit of work. I do musical theater work. Like I mentioned, I was doing West Side Story. I'm about to do a show at Signet in Old Town till June. So I'm literally playing 7 shows a week for a couple months straight. And then I freelance a bit. I put out my own records. All of this music that I've been playing, by the way, I have recordings of. I have a new record that was nominated for Jazz Album of the Year at the music San Diego Music Awards. I have all these different things. But I never make quite enough money. So my main job is watching my kids and then trying to pay half of the bills. Anything else? Anybody else? I know everybody wants to come up here and go like this. Do it. Thanks, y'all, for hanging out.
Thank you.